Good morning all. I'm here to talk about a genomic analysis of South Indian community patients who presented to us with autosomal dominant cortical tremor, myoclonus and epilepsy. My main aim of talk is to share about how to identify a clinical phenotype followed by how to characterize them genetically. And throughout the talk, I'll be sharing my experiences, how we proceeded with this study. I'm working as an associate professor of neurology in Tirunelveli Medical College, where we did this study. The disease I'm going to talk about, a mild introduction about the disease. It is a familial adult onset myoclonic epilepsy. It is also called as autosomal dominant cortical tremor, myoclonus and epilepsy, with the clinical features of what the disease has. The disease is of autosomal dominant inheritance with a high degree of penetrance. And the main characteristic prior of the disease are the presence of cortical tremors and the presence of myoclonic jerks and sometimes generalized tonic-clonic seizures also. All the patients need not have all the three components, but majority of the patients will have. Since it is an autosomal dominant disorder, they will have formae frustae of the disease. So it goes by multiple names, namely benign adult onset myoclonic epilepsy, familial essential myoclonic epilepsy, and previously what I said was autosomal dominant cortical tremor, myoclonus and epilepsy. It goes by different name in different countries. Now they are modifying the term as per the clinical features. And the age of onset can be, even though it is called as an adult onset, now we are seeing cases who are presenting less than 8 years of age because of the genetic anticipation. And in general, the age of onset is 11 to 50 years. And the characteristic features of what I said previously is presence of cortical tremors, which is a fine shivering tremors of upper limb, predominantly the hands, sometimes can also involve the proximal part. And it is intensified by anxiety, that is very important, and posture and also fine movements. Emotional and physical stress will generally increase these tremors. These tremors are very fine and they also sometimes involve the whole body in severe diseases. And the myoclonic jerks are also erratic jerks, which are an arrhythmic jerks. They are not rhythmic jerks as in other diseases, they are arrhythmic jerks. And it's also predominantly seen distally and also in the proximal parts of the hands. Again, aggravated by emotional and physical stress, sleep deprivation. And they are also photic sensitive, phonic sensitive, and followed by seizures. If myoclonus is going to intensify, then sometimes they may culminate in seizures also. Seizures is predominantly generalized tonic-clonic seizures, but we are also seeing complex partial seizures. Again, to repeat, they are also precipitated by sleep deprivation, photic stimulus, and also sometimes phonic stimulus also. And there are also other comorbid conditions which have been reported with ADCME. Many of the families also has reported mental retardation sometimes, even though majority of the patients who presented to our pedigree have a normal mental state, but associated mental retardation has also been reported in some families. They can have concurrent migraine, again confusing it with JME. Blindness have been reported in very rare cases, and they also have a high degree of infertility as found in our study. And in predominance, the patient has gotten normal cognition and the mental state is also normal. And majority of these patients are also highly qualified and they are working as doctors, engineers and so on. And it is predominantly a non-progressive disease, but we are seeing a very, very slow progression as the disease crosses 20 to 30 years. In very few patients and very few families, we are also seeing a bit faster progression. And the diagnosis is mainly by clinical picture, and it is supported by neurophysiological studies like electroencephalogram, somatosensory evoke potential. And it has been characterized by different abnormalities in EEG and also in somatosensory evoke potential, which I'll be discussing. This has been described very few families in Japan. Now they have also have numerous families in Japan, and there also it is predominantly seen in a single community. It is also seen in China as far as South Asia is concerned. As far as European countries are concerned, it has been reported from France, Italy, And there are numerous countries which are reporting it now. As I previously discussed, it has got a high penetrance and genetic heterogeneity is there. As discussed, South Asian population has got variations in chromosome 8, whereas European population has got the defects in chromosome 2. As far as Indian studies are concerned, they have reported one family from Rajasthan, from Savai Mansingh Medical College in the year 2014. This is my alma mater, where I saw the first case, the prototype case actually. When I was doing my DM neurology final year in 2008, I saw the first patient who presented with these clinical features. At the time, the diagnosis was not clear actually. We discharged the patient as simple seizure disorder, and that patient has actually migrated from the place where I found all these cases, namely Tirunelveli, and he was actually working as a shopkeeper in Chennai, and he has migrated from Chennai, and he admitted after Deepavali with all the clinical features. The thing got precipitated because of the sleep deprivation. So that was the first case. So next, when I joined Department of Neurology, Tirunelveli, as an assistant professor, I started seeing some more similar patients with the same clinical features what I saw. Even now, we didn't have the diagnosis actually. I used to discuss with my professor, whatever difficult cases I have, if I'm not able to come to a diagnosis, he asked me to start collecting the cases. So we started collecting the patients, and patients went with different diagnoses like essential tremor variant, or it goes by the name of familial adult onset myoclonic epilepsy. And one fine day, my professor coined the term also, and he called me and told that autosomal dominant cortical tremor and myoclonus fits very well with the patients what you have. And from then on, we started collecting these patients. This is how I started the disease and how the clinical phenotype was identified. And my professor is Dr. Natarajan, who is a senior professor in Madras Institute of Neurology. And this place is also very important as far as my study is concerned, because we identify the index case of the ADCME cohort. Actually, this is a church. Many patients with neurodegenerative changes are left in this church, hoping that God will heal them actually. So when I went there in search of my index patient, after getting the address from the nominal register, when I went there, he said he was there actually. And he also said that many of his family members are also affected by these diseases. That was the first clue that the disorder can be familial. So this is, he was one of the earliest person in our cohort actually. So these are all the clinical signs to show on. This is the tremor, which I described now, which is a shivering movements of the upper limbs. And intermittently, if you closely watch, you can also see the myoclonic jerks. A jerky movement is the characteristic of this tremor when compared to that of other tremors. This tremor is on reprocessing. Recorded from one of the patients in OPD. This is an example, another patient with a similar tremor. We can see the fine quality tremor, which is a shivering movement. Intermittently, we can see the myoclonic jerks in the proximal part. So this is to show the severe intensity of the tremor. So you can see that the whole body is tremulous. And if the tremors are very severe, these patients won't be able to stand. They will have difficulty in standing. And you can see that the whole body is jerking. Because of these myoclonic jerks and also the tremors. When the myoclonic jerks increases in intensity, definitely most of the patients culminate in seizures. Again, to come in to put it in a nutshell. So the clinical signs, patients included in the ADCME cohort has got tremors, myoclonus, and seizures. All I have described previously. So differential diagnosis, what we considered initially in this patients before coining the term of autosomal, before coming to the conclusion of the coined term like autosomal dominant cortical tremor and epilepsy, we thought it could be an ET variant because of the tremor predominance. cortical tremor is the term first introduced by Ikada, Professor Ikada, who is actually working on patients from Japan mainly. And he is working on this autosomal dominant cortical tremor and epilepsy. And he has got multiple publications in this. And we have to differentiate it from juvenile myoclonic epilepsy, where the patient can have myoclonic jerks, again, which are stimulus sensitive, which resembles these patients. Again, they're aggravated by sleep deprivation. They can also have a family history. So all these things can be there. And sometimes some of the patients who are on JME also report tremor due to the treatment they take, because predominant of the juvenile myoclonic epilepsy patients will be on sodium valproate. So as a result of the medication also, they can have tremors. So this has to be differentiated again. And the third entity is progressive myoclonic epilepsy. And this can be differentiated from ADCME in that the cognitive decline is very preponderant and the disease is progressive in progressive myoclonic epilepsy. So that can be easily differentiated. So this is to show the EEG abnormalities in patients with autosomal dominant cortical tremor, myoclonus and epilepsy. And we can see the spike and wave pattern, which is bilateral bisynchronous. And this is the SSEP abnormality we saw in patients with ADCME. There is a Jaint N20 or cortical potential to show that the tremors are of cortical origin, which is very important in these patients. This is to show the another clinical features, that is the familial transmission. Here you can see four-generation transmission with autosomal dominant pattern of inheritance with a high degree of penetration. We are also seeing genetic anticipation in these patients. So we treated the patients predominantly with sodium valproate, and clonazepam. And Professor Ikada has also used the perampanel, since now we not have used, and he said that it's of very use to the patients. And we also had a bit of beta blockers when the tremor is predominant. And most patients also respond better to beta blockers also in addition to valproate and clonazepam if the tremor is resistant. So we started the clinical documentation in 2011 after getting the permission from the ethical committee meeting. So we started documenting all the patients who enter the department, and many of the patients also voluntarily brought their relatives also, making us easy to make the clinical documentation. So the collection becomes included a large number of patients thereby. So after analyzing after the clinical documentation, now we have a cohort of around 726 individuals in 122 affected family pedigrees. Of which 102 individuals in 66 families were genetically characterized. In our study, the average age of onset is 41.89 years, and age of onset is 15 to 40 years predominantly, predominantly male gendered. And the oldest patient in our study is 69 years, and the youngest patient is 8 years. The gap is huge, actually. And we also have patients from all the cohort patients belong to Tirunelveli district, except from four patients who was referred by a doctor family himself from Ahmedabad, who was also included in the study. This study has included patients with all socioeconomic groups, including doctors, engineers, business persons. There are numerous persons which are included in the study of all cadre, all socioeconomic cadre, and are of all intelligence like. Number of families affected was 122, out of which 5 had no family history. Affected individuals were 726, which was calculated from the pedigree chart. Affected alive is 511, and affected dead is 215. The other phenotypes have previously discussed, identified in this study, is a high degree of infertility in these patients, and also history of sudden death and myocardial and mental retardation was there. So number of families sampled for genetic study is 90. Genetic characterization was done in 66 families. They are working on the negative families also now. Number of individuals sampled individually is 159 from those 66 families. Clinical features of the analysis. The first presenting feature was seizure in 60%, whereas it was tremors in 40%, and very few presented with myoclonic jerks. And the seizure type was predominantly GTCS, and they had predominant psychiatric comorbidities. Usually psychiatric comorbidities in epilepsy are reported with complex partial seizures rather than generalized tonic-clonic seizures. Whereas these patients who predominantly have genetic generalized tonic-clonic seizures also has got a high degree of psychiatric comorbidities. The degree is very high, and these patients have gotten phobia, panic, they have a generalized anxiety disorder also. So investigations, most of the patients showed generalized pike and wave discharges and focal discharges also seen in some patients who are on treatment already started by some other neurologists who have seen them outside. There were many frontal fragments were there since the patient was on treatment. Slowing was seen when the EEG was taken in postictal state, and normally also we see some mild degree of slowing, and it was normal in 6%. And CT brain was actually done. It's not 42. It was done in all the patients, and predominantly had 42 showed non-specific changes like occasional calcification, false end calcification, basal ganglia calcification, and the MRI brain showed non-specific changes. So proceeded on with MRS, and we're also doing a detailed study on the MRI findings of these patients. It's just an example of what showed in MRS of these patients. The choline creatinine ratio was found to be very high in these patients, and our radiologists also have identified some degree of pigment deposition in the dentate nucleus also. This is very premature, so we have to study more to give the exact details of what happened in the MRS or what is happening functionally also in these patients. Analysis of the pedigree showed 17 families showed consanguineous marriages. And generation of the index patient, we had a predominant second generation primary only, and third generation primary was also there. And the first generation and fourth generation primary were minimal. And person affected in each generation was also calculated. Generation 1 was 31.52, whereas in generation 2, it is maximally affected, 44%. And generation 3 is 21, and generation 4 is 2.73%. Extent of transmission, no known transmission. It's standing with the first pedigree itself is 4.17. And one generation transmission is 45. And two generation transmission is 41. Three generation transmission is 8.33. Types of transmission, we also seen father to son transmission, father to daughter, mother to son, mother to daughter. All degree of transmission has been seen within these patients. This is a picture representation. So 76 patients in 122 family were analyzed. To our surprise, when we are actually concising it for a presentation in epilepsy conference in Hyderabad, when we were putting all the analyzing all the things, we found out to our surprise that all of them belong to a unique native South Indian community. Even to be more precise, they belong to a specific sub-community also. And while analyzing this community, we found this community has got a high incidence of inbreeding, meaning they don't differentiate between religion like Christian or Hindus. They marry in between them. So they are a restricted amount of population. So they repeatedly marry in between. So even though consanguinity is not so high, they have a high incidence of inbreeding. And numerous unique haplotypes have also been described in these patients by our former professor of neurology, Dr. Sridharan. So he has described, now he is a professor in Madurai Medical College. So he has described the unique HLA haplotypes in this community. So the first presentation was in ECON Hyderabad, where we presented, and most of the judges were happy with the presentation, but they asked us to proceed with the genetic studies, which is going to make the study more attractive and interesting. So while after completing the phenotypic analysis, we thought we have to analyze them genetically also. At that time, genetic studies was not available in India, and Indian patients were not genetically characterized, but genetically characterization has been done in South Asian population, namely in Japanese. Similar to the community, what we see here, they have seen only in Han Chinese descent. And Europeans also, they have identified the chromosome, but the gene was not identified till then. So it has got a genetic heterogeneity. Different chromosomes have been affected in different country people. A search for the genetic determinants lead us to the next phase. So we have to find for the funds. So we have to go through a specific steps to find out how to do the genetic analysis. This is modern health research unit at Kallur, so that field visits can be done with the help of these people in the rural research unit. This is again to show how the field studies is carried out in our research unit. It's also an actively functioning one. So the first search for the fund started when I presented this in a research workshop at Tirunelveli Medical College in front of our ICMR director at that time, Dr. Kratoch sir. And out of 22 projects projected, six projects were selected actually to be presented in Delhi. So the next presentation was at Delhi in front of Dr. O.P. Tandon and a neurologist from AIMS. Out of 22, four were selected actually for funding. So since after that we started the field study, we started going from place to place to collect the clinical details of the patients, and also we started sampling some of our patients actually. And as a full clinical phenotype was characterized, the first publication came in 2016 in Epilepsia with the title of Autosomal Dominant Cortical Tremor, Myoclonus in Epilepsy in a Unique South Indian Community. This is the report. So from that, they have gone to the next level actually. So to find out the genetic phenotypes, it was the most tough one actually. We've gone through many centers, even many abroad centers actually. With payment also, it is very difficult to transfer the biological content across our country, number one. And it was so high, the rates are so high, and it is an unknown gene. Even for a known gene, the cost is very high. And most of the people are not ready to do for an unknown gene also. And even in India, we contacted many institutes, but our scientist working in research unit met Dr. Sridhar Sarasubhu, is the senior scientist in CSIR IGIB in one of the meetings in Chennai. That was the turning point for the study. Actually, after that, we contacted Dr. Sridhar through proper channels, and Dr. Sridhar Sivasubhu sir and Dr. Vinod sir gave a helpful hand. From then on, actually, with the help of my husband, all four of us linked together, and the study went to the next level actually. This is the Guardian Network. So they got enrolled us in the Guardian Network. For a few persons who don't know what is Guardian is, if we want to work on a rare diseases, it's a good collaboration between the clinician and the geneticist. Here, clinician also gets a prime importance, and also genetician also gets the clinical samples to work on actually. And this is a genomics for understanding of rare diseases. It is a purely Indian Alliance network. So we want to work on this. So we have to get enrolled in the Guardian. And there are numerous collaborators who are working in Guardian now. After enrolling in Guardian, we went to me and my husband, Dr. Shantaraman, who is a professor of pathology and vice principal, Tirunelveli Medical College, went to CSIR, where we got trained under Dr. Sridhar sir and Dr. Vinod sir. We got trained in preliminary knowledge in whole exome sequencing, whole genome sequencing, and also bioinformatics. Previously, I thought genetic studies are so easy. If you send a blood sample and the result will come, so that we can interpret it very easily, but it's not so. For unknown gene, we have to wait a lot. We have to analyze a lot. And people are struggling there to get our results. The second review at Tirunelveli Medical College, the director was then Dr. Soumya Swaminathan. They used to come for the review of projects frequently. So the second review was in 2016 after the start of the genetic study. So this was the pedigree which was selected for the genetic analysis. We selected four families actually. In general, it's a common approach actually to the genomic approach for understanding actually to how to proceed with the genetic test. So if you know the gene well, it's very easy. We can do through candidate gene or targeted panels. So the specific genes are studied. It's a cheaper one because we can go through a less amount of data only is required. And if you know the disease, we can study that gene alone. but this won't identify any novel genes because we are targeted towards the specific gene which causes the disease. So if nothing is found in the candidate gene, then we can go to the next level, like the whole exome sequencing. The whole exome sequencing read all the exon portions, which codes for the protein, like a protein coding region is red. And it occupies 98% of the genome. And this exons actually, defects in these exons is responsible for more than 98% of the Mendelian disorders. So whole exome sequencing identify majority of the disorders, and it requires less data, less time, and it is less costly when compared to that of the whole genome sequencing. But if the disease is an intron, we cannot identify through whole genome sequencing, and repeat disorders also, it's very difficult to find out from whole exome sequencing. So next thing will be the whole, if nothing is found in the whole exome sequencing, then we have to proceed through the whole genome sequencing. It's a very lengthy process, requires a very lot amount of data, and it is very costly when compared to that of the candidate gene panels and also the whole exome sequencing. So for identifying the novel genes, we have to go through either whole exome sequencing or the whole genome sequencing. So this is the process by which the whole exome sequencing is carried out. So after the blood is collected, the DNA has to be separated by using NGS platforms. And after separation of the DNA, and it has to be analyzed, and then the variants has to be read after and has to be segregated by adding on the different clinical phenotypes information also. At the end of whole exome sequencing, we were not able to identify any pathogenic single nucleotide variants or insertion or deletion. So at the end of whole exome sequencing, it becomes inconclusive in 2016. So the next step, when the whole exome sequencing is inconclusive, we have to proceed to the next one. So that is the whole genome sequencing. So these patients underwent whole genome sequencing. Two families, actually, four individuals, one affected and one unaffected from two families were selected. In 2017, at the end of WGS also, it was not a straight through. They were not able to find out the phenotype associated pathogenic SNVs or insertion deletion were observed in these affected individuals. So at that level, WGS also turned inconclusive. It was very difficult. When the WGS turned inconclusive, several things has to be thought of. So we thought whether the clinical diagnosis is wrong. So whether we have to consider the clinical diagnosis again, having so much work of genetic work has been done, when the clinical diagnosis is wrong, everything goes wrong. So, but they took a huge effort, actually, Dr. Sridhar sir and Dr. Vinod sir took a huge effort. They said, we'll manually inspect the genomic loci because we know it's a South Asian. So the affected chromosome can be 8. So they thought they'll manually inspect the genetic loci, which is previously described in the literature, that is the chromosome 8. So 2018, when they manually inspect and they did a repeat prime PCR, which gave the lead actually. So the repeat primed polymerase chain reaction, it is a RP-PCR, helped in identification of the repeats. It was a repeat disorder, pentanucleotide repeat disorders, which are usually not picked up by WES, and manual inspection only helps in finding out the RP-PCR variation for the expanded repeat. It's a pentanucleotide repeat disorder. So whole genome sequencing helps in segregating the intronic repeats. It was in chromosome 8, and they also identified the gene now. It is the SAMD12 gene. It is the TTTCA repeat. It's a pentanucleotide repeat disorder. So here in unaffected, we are not able to see any of the insertions here, but whether you can see the repeat insertions here. So we have to read from this side. So you can see the abnormal pentanucleotide repeats in this region, which is producing the disease. Since it's a repeat disorder, it's also showing a high degree of genetic anticipation also. While we were working, the Japanese people were also working actually, and they were also able to find out the similar repeat disorders like TTTCA and TTTTA in chromosome 8 at that time. And in April 2018, they published in Nature Genetics. So this is to show the abnormal expansions here. It takes a ladder pattern. where they link a fluorescent primed polymerase chain repeats actually. So when they introduced it, it gets attached to the abnormal region here, so that it fluorescently enlights the abnormal region, which is usually seen as a ladder pattern here. So no ladder pattern is seen in the unaffected person, whereas you can see the ladder pattern in the affected person here. So this is to describe the abnormality in another family where you can see the ladder pattern RP primed PCR. These are all the abnormal repeats which get attached in this sequence to produce the disease. Again, this from family 1 to show the abnormal insertions and expansions. So small detail about the SAMD12 gene. SAMD12 is present in all eukaryocytes. It's present predominantly in most of the cells. As you can see, all the cell types in the human body are represented. But the important thing is that it has got a high degree of concentration in the nervous system, central nervous system. Particularly, more concentration have been seen in the Purkinje cells. So expression is found mainly in the Purkinje cell and granular cell layers, which make us think that the tremor predominant manifestation can be because of the involvement of the Purkinje cell layer, which is the predominant outflow tract in the cerebellum. So the site of pathology can be cerebellum, but more studies are required, more autopsy studies and also functional MRI studies are required to find out the exact site of pathology in these disorders. So it is SAM, its expansion is sterile alpha motif domain. It's a 70 residue structure. It's present in all human beings. So it's a diverse one, and throughout all eukaryocytes has carried this gene. After completing the genetic, found out the genetic defect, we have to start the genomic survey. So collecting a sample from the population is also not easy for genetic studies because all the families cannot travel to our institution, but predominant people brought their family actually. But for the big families, we have to go to their place to collect the samples. And also while collecting the samples, we also did the detailing about the pedigrees and other clinical features also. So in 2019, we also had a bioinformatics workshop, which is organized by Dr. Sridhar sir and Dr. Vinod sir. Like me, many of our colleagues are also now interested in genetic studies, and there are around 8 to 9 projects which are running in collaboration with CSIR. So they used to come to our place to train us. And we also in reciprocation go to Delhi for training. So at the end of all this struggle in 2020, the genomic profile is published. Now it is the largest Indian cohort, which is genetically worldwide. It is genetically characterized cohort. So this is the timeline at which it went through. So it requires a lot of patience. It took 11 years to complete the study. After identifying the clinical phenotype actually was completed in 2015, got published in 2016, and the search for genomic determinants start here. And after a period of 5 years with a lot of hard work from scientists from CSIR, Dr. Sridhar sir and Dr. Vinod sir, and many scientists who worked in this study, so that our dream came true actually. We were able to identify the genetic abnormality. So how to plan further? So we know that TTCA insertion is associated with FAMI. So this FAMI is lying in between now. So when we consider it as an epilepsy, then it is going to be the first repeat disorder which is going to be associated with epilepsy. When we consider it as a neurodegenerative disease, it's not much of a progression. So it is standing in between. So we don't know which route it is going to take. So it is not classified under ILAE also. So it shows that non-codic repeat expansion can also cause epilepsy. And the main aim is that cost-effective screening test like RP-PCR is available. So with the whole genome sequencing, when the study started, the cost was around 3.3. So now with the RP-PCR testing, it has come down actually. So with the amount of around 1,000 rupees itself, we can now identify the familial adult onset myoclonic epilepsy. So our concentration now is to have an impact on the precise molecular diagnosis, we have to screen the carriers, and we have to identify the genetic anticipation, and the prenatal diagnosis also can be given by proper counseling to the persons in that community. And we also have to create an awareness among the clinical fraternity and patients, and also among the neurologists, that this disease is existing. So this is the translation of our experience. Thank you. Especially thank all my patients who stood with me, and all my teachers and all my mentors, particularly persons from CSIR, IGIB, who have worked with us and make our dream come true. I thank the entire Department of Neurology, and I thank my husband, Dr. Shantaraman, who stood with me throughout the study. So with the help of all the other people and all the other scientists from CSIR, we were able to come to a genomic diagnosis also. Thank you. Thanks a lot for hearing my experience. Thank you.